Good evening, everyone, and a warm welcome to your YouTube channel, CA Sansar. We have been regularly conducting webinars on various topics under the Income Tax Act and GST. We received so many requests from our members to host a webinar on Prevention of Money Laundering Act, or PMLA. We are fortunate to have with us today Advocate Ashwani Taneja, sir. He shall be discussing fundamental questions arising under PMLA. A few words about our speaker. Sir is a former member of ITAT, fellow member of Indian Council of Arbitration, New Delhi. He is also a fellow member of ICAI, ICSI, ICWA. He has also done masters in law. He practiced as a chartered accountant from 1995 to 2007 in varied areas of auditing, due diligence, tax planning, litigation, etc. Between 2007 to 15, he practiced as a lawyer with RRA Tax India and appeared before ITAT, High Court and Supreme Court. In 2015, he was elevated as member of the tribunal and was posted at Mumbai bench, where he delivered more than 2,000 judgments covering wide variety of issues. Then in 2017, he resigned as member tribunal and joined back his old charm and passion, the legal profession. Currently, he's practicing as a lawyer with RRA Legal and specializing in the area of anti-money laundering law, Benami law, Black Money Act, Serious Fraud Investigation Office, and Income Tax. He regularly appears before Educating Authority, Appellate Tribunal of Benami Law, PMLA, ITAT, High Court, and Honorable Supreme Court of India. He's a prolific speaker and has delivered numerous presentations and lectures on different forums across the country regarding various issues of PMLA, Benami Law, and Income Tax Law. A very warm welcome to you, sir. We also share a warm welcome to Dr. R.N. Das, former Acting Chairman and Member PMLA, Tribunal, and former DG, International Taxation. Sir, we are privileged by your august presence on our channel. Also, a very warm welcome to CA Vivek Khurana, sir, founder of CA Sansar. I request, sir, to please address the session.
Thank you very much, Neha ji. Respected R.N. Das ji, CA Ashwani Taneja ji, and CA Neha Gupta ji, all other respected members of the profession, a warm welcome to all of you at today's webinar on PMLA. And first of all, my sincere thanks to CA Ashwani Taneja ji for his valuable time he has given to us, and also to Dr. R.N. Das for very short period of time he joined us. Sir, thank you very much. And we have done webinar on Benami with Ashwani Taneja ji in Jan, but now it's almost 6 months. Sir, kafi time le liya aapne. And at that time, it was a grand hit of that webinar. And we have received many appreciation for our last week's webinar. And thank you very much to all of you. It's only because of your love and support. And for this week also, we are coming with a series of webinars with very eminent speakers like our elder brother Ashwani Taneja ji, our guru Dr. R.N. Das ji. And regarding today's webinar on prevention of money laundering, I think Ashwani Taneja ji ne itne webinar kare hain, shayad unka naam mere ko lagta hai kisi din Guinness book mein aa jayega on Benami and PMLA. Seriously, very vast knowledge and vast experience about that. And but yes, again, few queries are there regarding the money laundering. Even on our request, he has also sent some few questions. So today we will discuss on that also. So before, without wasting any time, now my request to Dr. R.N. Das ji to please say a few words, and then we'll over to Ashwani Taneja ji. R.N. Das ji, please, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Vivek Khurana ji. I'm grateful to you to ask me to speak a few words, and the opportunity is good because it is a large number of professionals gather in this webinar, and it is good to be with all of you. My young friend, Mr. Aswini Taneja, will certainly enthrall you with his usual charm of and presentations on this subject. But I must say, anti-money laundering law in India, as it is a tough law, and many call it a draconian law. It brings with it lots of disabilities for a person who gets involved in such a problem, such a money laundering issue. As it is, our legal process is long, that takes time. So the best way is not to get involved in any money laundering activity. Make absolute due diligence. Don't allow anybody to put a check in your account or encash a check or like that. Even if you buy something, make due diligence. You sell something, make due diligence. Take a loan, make due diligence. So that you avoid this kind of issue. And moreover, another word, the anti-money laundering law gives a great scope to professionals for their practice. So, and CAs and lawyers, everybody have a good chance of practice in this new field. So with that, I would say that now Mr. Taneja will explain the nuances of the law in greater details. And thank you very much.
Yes, now it's over to Aswini ji to guide us regarding the PMLA and how we chartered accountant can do much more practice into this PMLA.
Yes.
So please guide us, sir. Yes.
First of all, thank you Neha ji for kind words and Vivek bhai for not only inviting me and Desab, but for the benefit of all of us professional brothers and sisters. You are regularly taking pains in dissemination of knowledge. Really, hats off to you. I mean, tirelessly, I have been witnessing since last 1 year the way you are organizing one program after the other, and every program really surpasses all the excellent standards of the previous programs. Really, thank you very much. And respected Desab, my guru in this field, now my partner also. Probably you are not aware that Desab has a rich experience of being a commissioner, first DG International Tax, and also that lastly the acting chairman of PMLA Tribunal. So this complex subject Desab has viewed from many angles, as a judge, now as a practitioner, and closely associated with some business entities also. And he has been in policy formation also. So I think he has the record of working with many prime minister, like Pranab Mukherjee, like P. Chidambaram, like Manmohan Singh ji. So I think let's take the benefit of his presence today. Now this subject, money laundering law, as Desab has rightly put, number one, this is tough. Number two, this is harsh. So what is that which makes this law tough? And what is that which makes this law as harsh? We will dwell upon all these two things and also the way forward. And also some of the fundamental questions which I had compiled for the immediate benefit of my professional brothers and sisters, and also the conceptual framework of this law. So let's begin the tour of anti-money laundering law in India. Friends, in fact, we had need to have some little historical background about this law, how this law was evolved in India. Was India pioneer in introducing the law, or it was done in pursuance to some global requirement? How it stands today, where it does the position of India stands today, and various things, etc., etc. In fact, I had got recently an occasion to interact with the Honorable Shri Suresh Prabhuji, who has been recently been very actively involved in reforms required in this law. And as you know, he is designated as Sherpa, India's Sherpa for G20 meetings. And India is going to organize the next meeting, which is to be held in 2022. So I have been getting an opportunity to work with him to find out the various avenues, various areas where the reforms are required in this law. So keeping in view all these things, the academic knowledge, the knowledge in this direction, and also the practical knowledge which we are having in handling the cases, I will mix up all the things for you so that I can present to you a proper bouquet which is required today. So as far as historical background goes back, in fact, way back in 90s, it was felt globally that many criminals are getting supported from the activities of laundering activities which they do, meaning thereby they launder the color of the money, and thereby they create a financial system which acts as a backbone and enables them to carry out the criminal activities in a continuous manner, in an unhindered manner. So therefore a need was felt that something should be done so that the money laundering activity could be stopped, because this is lifeline for any international criminal organization. So if this money laundering is stopped, money laundering is channelizing the money from good resources to bad and vice versa, bad to good. So if this kind of streaming is stopped, this kind of channels are blocked, then it becomes for a person with a criminal background to continue with the criminal activities. So therefore, at global platform, it was felt necessary that something should be done so that the meanness of the this money laundering could be curbed. So keeping in view that some certain resolutions were passed at United Nations organization, and one task force was also constituted, and the whole purpose of the same was to persuading the member countries to bring out a legislation to curb money laundering in the respective jurisdictions. So in line with such resolutions, when the Financial Action Task Force was constituted and resolutions were passed, in line with that, because India wanted to adhere to any such global requirements, one activity started in 1998, and which was named as drafting of legislation with regard to money laundering. So anti-money laundering activities started. So eventually it took the shape of the act. First bill came in 1998. And then eventually it became Act in 2002. So that is how anti-money laundering law came into force in our country, in line with the global requirements coming through United Nations, so that the money laundering activities could be stopped, to stop the heinous crimes such as smuggling, such as drug peddling, terrorism, counterfeiting, etc., etc. That is a different thing. That since then, the scope and arena of this law has been enlarged so much that not only these heinous crimes or serious crimes are involved, but many routine crimes have also been involved. So it has today become an omnibus kind of legislation, and which you have noted from this example also, that in the time of Corona, when there is lockdown all over, but one department which is tirelessly working, uninterrupted working, which has not been deactivated, is the enforcement agency who is implementing this law, that is PMLA law, and that is called Enforcement Directorate, as you are all aware about. So friends, that is little bit about how Act came into picture in our country. Today, as you know, this Act is most toughest Act, as is being said, and also the most harsh one. And also this agency is really the most active agency today. Every day in, day out, we are getting to hear that in this particular state or in this particular city, these many assets of so-and-so has been attached by the Enforcement Directorate. And yesterday also some attachments have been done. Last week also some attachments have been done, and this is going on. So firstly, what does make this law so tough? Why it is not so easy to understand? In fact, there are two, three reasons for this. The first reason I would say that this law has a mixture of many laws. I mean, to understand this law, one has to understand the criminal jurisprudence, the CRPC, not only CRPC, then CPC also, then accounting background, then financial background, then provisions of Companies Act, provisions of Indian Evidence Act, and few other things. And the way law has been created, probably there it lacks some clarity. And because of the lack of clarity, the confusions take place. The implementation becomes quite, erratic sometime, not rational also. So that makes its understanding very, very difficult. And that is probably the reason for being it so harsh also. So it has become such a scenario that neither a chartered accountant nor a lawyer alone can handle this. So in fact, the proper fusion of legal background and accounting background and financial background is needed to take up this law in appropriate manner. We will understand it more appropriately in more detail. Firstly, I will try to put before you this slide, which is open before you. This slide I have put before you to show that the connect of the ED has become so wide. Kindly see, in this slide I am showing you that two chimpanzees were attached by the Enforcement Directorate. And you must be thinking, chimpanzees and Enforcement Directorate? I mean, I was also amused when I read this news in the newspaper. And it was quite surprising to even analyze that how chimpanzees could be attached by the Enforcement Directorate. But I will give you the answer how it happened. In fact, there is a concept of scheduled offense under PMLA, that if a person commits any scheduled offense, and from scheduled offense, if he earns any proceeds of crime, then those proceeds of crime are liable to be attached by the Enforcement Directorate. I will explain it in detail. So one gentleman did, some forgery. He created some certificate, and then he did some violation of Wildlife Protection Act, and he got hold of these two chimpanzees. So in a way, it was held that he has committed scheduled offense, because Wildlife Protection Act and forgery is punishable under IPC. So this forgery as well as Wildlife Protection Act, they are both named as scheduled offenses under the Schedule 2 PMLA. So in a way, he can be said to have done some scheduled offense, and then these two chimpanzees, by doing the scheduled offense, he can be said to have earned that pursuits of crime from there. So he earned pursuits of crime from that scheduled offense, and that is how these pursuits of crime are liable to be attached by Enforcement Directorate. So that is how a connect can be made between the Enforcement Directorate and the chimpanzees. And I will give you many more case studies on the basis of which you cannot even gauge that, I mean, how connect is so wide. Recently, you must have heard that because of some insistence or instruction of the Brazilian government, ED has made attachment of 67 companies' bank account in one go, without even issuing notices those companies, without even giving show cause notice. Just straight away, the accounts were attached. So whether ED has such kind of wide powers or not, or there is some kind of misuse of powers or not, or the subject is itself that such kind of vagueness remains therein. I mean, these are the things which every countryman is probably facing, every businessman, every business entity is facing. Sometimes I feel that probably the officers are not also properly trained or guided that in what manner the law is to be properly implemented. You must have read this news recently in the newspaper also, that Modi's Benami Law has companies running for cover. And huge Benami assets worth more than ₹6,900 crores has been attached. Now this number has still increased. Many more may have reached more than 10,000 crores by now. And it is hitting, very badly to business entities, because people have been caught unaware because of this introduction of new Benami Law. So if we talk about combination of Benami Law and anti-money laundering law, probably it becomes very difficult for anybody to escape if he has done anything illegal. Now, friends, one thing more I would like to state here. That earlier, what used to happen was that the enforcement was done through income tax law or at the most indirect taxes law. But gradually it was felt that these two laws are not sufficient to tackle the situation which our country was facing. The economy was dented, there was leakages, and because of this revenue leakages, parallel economy was running. So it was getting very difficult every day passing. So therefore, in its wisdom, the government has brought out various laws dealing with economic offences, such as by reinforcement of this PMLA and thus introduction of new Benami law, then Black Money Act, then banning of Unregulated Deposits Act, then Fugitive Economic Offenders Act, etc., etc. So it has been felt now the government is able to tighten the noose to a great extent by way of these laws. Now the cost of non-compliance has become really very, very high than the cost of compliance. So therefore, people are really willing not to do any non-compliance at all with respect to anything and to do the things straightforward. That is the achievement which these laws could be made. Though in this process, there is some harsh actions which are taking place, which can be avoided if the laws are implemented in graceful and fair manner. Now, kindly see this news also I would like to share with you. CBI ED action may now follow IT default probes. You must have heard that now the agencies are going to work hand to hand in synchronized manner, and these three agencies are coordinating among themselves as well as using the power of higher data analytics. And you would have heard definitely that recently Central Board of Direct Taxes has also entered MOUs with various agencies such as SEBI, MSMEs, etc., etc. So in a way, the new era is going to come when on the one hand, the agencies are going to work in tandem. On the other hand, the new laws have been brought out in such a way that the one law is affecting the other. There is going to be a strong interplay between various laws. So because of this strong combination interplay of various laws and agencies working in tandem, it will be very difficult to do any illegal exercise and then escape, because any person who is an offender or a defaulter or a wrongdoer will be caught from any corner, one or the other. So money laundering, coming back to straight to the subject, money laundering. What is this money laundering in common parlance and then in legal terms? Any guess on that? In fact, the moment I talk about money laundering, somebody would say, sir, money laundering means converting black to white. You may be partly right if you think so, not fully. Because converting black to white may be solely due to the reason of tax evasion also. And if it is solely due to that reason, that will may not amount strictly in money laundering, concept of money laundering. Because tax evasion alone, it is taken care by the income tax department, by the income tax law. So money laundering is something beyond that. So what is that beyond it, which then can be said to be money laundering? So though some amendment has been made, somebody was asking me about the amendment also, which has been made from 1st August 2019 only, which is trying to shake the conceptual background. But for the sake of better clarity and easy understanding, as of now, I will be taking the conceptual background unaffected with any recent amendment. So if we go by conceptual understanding, money laundering means something where the color is not converted from maybe black to white, but maybe from red to white. Now, what do we mean by red to white here? Now, red to white, I would say that when the color is red means there is something more than mere tax evasion. And what is that something more? Where the crime factor is also involved. So red denotes crime, commission of crime, where a person does some crime, earns some proceeds, and those proceeds he tries to show as if these are not proceeds of crime, but from some legit activities. So legitimizing the bad money as good money. So showing the tainted property as untainted is the exercise of money laundering. Meaning thereby, a person does some crime, and from the crime, he earns some proceeds, and he portrays that proceeds as if it is not from crime, but from legitimate activities. That will be said to be, money laundering. So that is the conceptual understanding. We will try to understand it in a more formal manner also. So these are some of the activities which are open before you in the form of the slide, which are globally done as money laundering activities. So if, for example, false export import invoices, stock market, showing bogus loans, creating bogus companies, property markets, etc., counterfeiting. So the first question which arises is that which legislation governs the concept of money laundering in India? As I shared with you, that it is Prevention of Money Laundering Act 2002, which prohibits and penalizes the money laundering activities in India. And what are the agencies and judicial authorities under the act? So firstly, the agency enforcement agencies, as its name suggests correctly, the Enforcement Directorate. So Enforcement Directorate has been given the task and the statutory duties and powers to enforce the law of PMLA under the country. So anti-money laundering activity is taken care by the Enforcement Directorate. Income tax law is taken care by the Income Tax Department. And Benami law is taken care by the Brahmi Prohibition Unit. Enforcement is done by Benami Prohibition Unit, which is carved out from the investigation wing of Benami, investigation wing of the Income Tax Department. Though the adjudication part and appeal part is done by the adjudicial authority and the appellate tribunal, which are common with the PMLA. But the enforcement agency is Income Tax Department, that wing of PPU only. But here, altogether, separate department is there, which is called as Enforcement Directorate. So it functions under the Act and does the activities like search, seizure, provisional attachment, arrest, initiate, prosecution, etc. These are the activities which are performed by the authorized officer under the Act. Then we have another agency in the rung above the Enforcement Directorate is the Adjudicating Authority, which is a quasi-judicial authority established under the Act, which exclusively adjudicates matters connected with the incidental to the attachment and retention of property. And it has also power to lay down its own procedure and etc., etc. It consists of chairman and two other members. Presently, Adjudicating Authority has only one bench, which is at Delhi only, having pan-India jurisdiction at Delhi. And then after the Adjudicating Authority, matter goes to the Appellate Tribunal. Appellate Tribunal is established, same tribunal which is of SAFEMA, but under Section 25, the tribunal has been established under PMLA, but the charge has been given of that tribunal to SAFEMA tribunal only. So the tribunal is common of SAFEMA, COFEPOSA, NDPS, that is narcotic drugs, and then PMLA, and then also Benami Law Tribunal. So six tribunal and FEMA also. So six or seven activities are being done by one tribunal only, which is called as SAFEMA Tribunal, AFTP in fact, Appellate Tribunal for forfeited properties for which it was originally constituted. So it is also located in Delhi, Loknayak Bhavan, having pan-India jurisdiction, and appeal there is to be filed within 45 days from the date of receipt of the order from the Adjudicating Authority. Then another authority in this entire exercise would be Special Court. Now this is a designated court of sessions, which is established under the Act for conducting the trial of offense of money laundering. So on the one hand, attachment part is taken care, that is the civil consequences are taken care by Adjudicating Authority and Appellate Tribunal, but the criminal part of it, that is a criminal trial, that is a punishment, imprisonment, that is taken care by the Special Court, that is a court of sessions. And this is governed by the procedure laid down under CRPC. And so what makes this law very, very harsh is in fact on account of two reasons. First reason is because of the web of action, and the other reason is burden of proof. And both of the things I will put before you one by one. I have placed one slide before you. Let the slide open. You can see, friends, that when the action starts under PMLA, two activities start simultaneously. Many activities which I have put in the slide before you. So as I said, the PMLA law is in fact a piggybacking law, meaning thereby it backs upon the laws, the actions initiated by some other agencies under some other laws. For example, there should have been commission of offense under some other law. For example, somebody has done some theft, some forgery, some cheating. So say some action is taken by, say, Income Tax Department or say by CBI. Then CBI will come into action and CBI will file a complaint or an FIR before the concerned court, etc. And that complaint will be pending, say, before the scheduled offense, before the competent jurisdictional court. In the meanwhile, report may be filed, complaint may be filed before the ED, or ED in any manner, if gets the information, then ED can simultaneously start two actions here. And what are the two actions? So first action would be that it can also file a complaint to the competent court, that is the same court of session where the scheduled offense is pending. And that complaint is filed under section 45 for prosecution of the offender who is accused of money laundering. And then it can simultaneously make attachment of the assets. So suppose a person has done cheating. So from cheating, he has earned some assets, some pursuits of crime, and from pursuits of crime, it has earned, accumulated, acquired some assets. Then ED can make attachment of those assets also. So it can pass provisional attachment order under section 5 of PMLA. So in a way, three actions simultaneously start. First, by that investigation agencies, say on account of that theft or cheating, then a complaint to criminal court by the ED, enforcement directorate under section 45, and then by ED alone, again, by the provisional attachment under section 5 of PMLA. And then that attachment part becomes pending. उनको बोलना मेरी ना वेबिनार चल रही है बोलो वेबिनार चल रही है मेरी सो देन बिफोर द एडजुडिकेटिंग अथॉरिटी देन इट बिकम्स पेंडिंग देन द मैटर्स बिकम देन द मैटर ऑफ अटैचमेंट गोस इट इज फाइल्ड इन द एडजुडिकेटिंग अथॉरिटी एंड देन बिफोर देन मैटर सो इन ए वे थ्री थिंग्स स्टार्ट एट अ टाइम सो वन इन्वेस्टिगेशन बिफोर द इन्वेस्टिगेशन द मेन शेड्यूल्ड ऑफेंस इन्वेस्टिगेशन एंड क्रिमिनल ट्रायल इज डन बाय द इन्वेस्टिगेशन एजेंसीज and then becomes pending before the special court. And then on the other hand, the complaint of that offense of money laundering, it also is becomes pending before the special court, also before the ED. And then the attachment proceedings in ED and as well as then matter goes to the adjudicating authority and then finally it goes before the appellate tribunal. So many actions start at a time. This is what makes this law very, very harsh. And then finally, as the progress takes place, the special courts takes care of ultimate conviction under scheduled offense and also conviction of the offense of money laundering. And then adjudicating authority and appellate tribunal decides about the attachment part, which ultimately goes other remedial forum would be High Court and Supreme Court. So this is one part. So many actions coming into motion together. Then the other part is burden of proof. It is said that there is a reverse burden of proof here, meaning thereby, it is said that the burden to prove is normally upon the person who is accusing another person to be guilty of offense based upon the fundamental principle of Constitution of India. But here it is reversed. So the burden is laid upon the person who is accused of offense of money laundering, that you have to prove that you are not involved in money laundering. That is also another area which makes this very harsh. Though there is little misunderstanding on the part of the enforcement agency here, I will try to clarify the same. But that is what makes this law very, very harsh. The two things make this law very, very harsh. Then let us come to the formal definitions. This is what I have explained so far in a generic sense. But how the offense of money laundering has been defined, what is money laundering and how the offense has been defined under the PMLA, Section 3 defines the same. I will read it for you here. So whosoever, directly or indirectly, whosoever directly or indirectly attempts to indulge or knowingly assists or knowingly is a party or is actually in any process or act connected with the pursuits of crime, including its concealment, possession, acquisition or use and projecting or claiming as untainted property, shall be guilty of offense of money laundering. So friends, kindly see, I have put this word "and" in red color here, and there is a specific reason for this. Now, the reason is that there is some kind of amendment. Now, because of this amendment, some people are getting this kind of impression that this, instead of the word "and", now the word "or" should be read here. So meaning thereby, the moment a person has done a scheduled offense and earned a pursuits of crime, it is not necessary that he should portray it as untainted for coming into the definition of money laundering. I mean, the moment first two steps are taken, it is money laundering. Third step may not be necessarily required to put him into the concept of money laundering. But friends, hold on. I mean, if it happens so, then it will amount to punishing a person, I mean, twice for same offense. Whereas, unless the third step is done, I don't think he can be said to have done the offense of money laundering. So three steps are necessary to put a person in the category of a person who is involved in the offense of money laundering. And I will share that amendment also with you. That amendment has been made with effect from 1st August 2019. It says that for the removal of doubts, it is hereby clarified that a person shall be guilty of offense of money laundering if such person is found to have directly or indirectly attempted to indulge or knowingly assisted or knowingly is a party or is actually involved in one or more of the following processes or activities connected with the pursuits of crime, namely concealment or possession or acquisition or use or projecting as untainted property or claiming as untainted property in any manner whatsoever. So kindly see the word or is there before projecting and after this projecting word also. So because of this placement of this word or, some people are getting confused that as if the third step may not be mandatory step. But my understanding is still that the conceptual framework has not been shaken by the legislature. So unless the person portrays the bad money as good money, I think he cannot be said to have been done the offense of money laundering. Then there is one more amendment which we can skip for the time being. Then, as I have said, pursuits of crime, a person earns pursuits from the crime. What do we mean by the word pursuits of crime? How section 2 bracket 1 bracket U will cover that? I mean, because this is an area which is another gray area because of which many, you know, controversies are arising, and an improper implementation of section 2 bracket 1 bracket U only is the major cause of worry today. If this is implemented properly, I think half of the unnecessary litigation can be avoided. So I will read whatever definition is there. It says pursuits of crime means any property derived or obtained directly or indirectly by any person as a result of criminal activity relating to a scheduled offense or the value of any such property or where such property is taken or held outside the country, then the property equivalent in the value held within the country or abroad. So kindly see, it is talking about two situations. One situation where the property is held in India and second situation where the property is held outside India. So the question which arises here is, what kind of properties can be attached? Only that properties which is involved in the offense of money laundering, or other properties can also be attached? So this is a very, very big question. In fact, law is very clear. I would say the proper reading of the law will make the things clear. If you see, two situations have been created here. I think in the next slides I will discuss with this, but for the time being I will simply say that what the law is saying is that property which is involved which is derived from the commission of offense. So suppose a person does some theft, and from theft he earns rupees 10 lakhs. So from these 10 lakhs, suppose he invests into the shares, buying of shares, and then he sells the shares and buys gold, and then he sells the gold and deposits into bank account. So I mean, anything, whatever I have stated, the gold, the shares, the bank account, and the cash itself, anything and everything can be put as pursuits of crime. And new amendment has been made in this section also, which pursuits of crime include property derived or obtained from the scheduled offense, but also any property which may be directly or indirectly be derived or obtained as a result of any criminal activity relatable to scheduled offense. So suppose a person has done two offenses, one is scheduled, another is not scheduled. So then it says, if it is related to the schedule, then any activity, any earning done from the allied activities shall also be treated as activity from the main activity of scheduled offense. So they have widened the scope of scheduled earnings made from the scheduled offense. Then what is scheduled offense? Now, scheduled offenses are the offenses as prescribed in the schedule to the PMLA, which is divided in three parts, that is part A, B, and C. The scheduled offense is the genesis of the offense of money laundering, as there cannot be any offense of money laundering unless and until an offense provided in the schedule of PMLA has first been committed. So there is a long list of scheduled offenses. The offenses mentioned in the schedule to the PMLA, and it has two, three categories as is mentioned. So broadly speaking, most of the offenses mentioned in IPC, they are covered there. And Wildlife Protection Act, Air Control Pollution Act, Water Pollution Control Act, Prevention of Corruption Act, and many more such laws have been covered over there. Yes, one section of Black Money Act has also been mentioned. So if black money violation takes place, it will be said to be scheduled offense, and PMLA can also take action upon that. So after black money, Benami law has not been mentioned there, fortunately. Tax evasion as such has not been mentioned over there. But any activity done while doing tax evasion, for example, any forgery, that may be covered because of the specific inclusion of forgery under IPC. Then what is the process of money laundering? As I have already discussed with you, that stage one, first of all, there is commission of scheduled offense, and then schedule two, there is generation of proceeds of crime, and then schedule three, stage three, that commission of money laundering by placement layering integration. So this, some people are taking this perception that stage three is no more required after the new amendment, which I think is not the correct interpretation. And if any such protection, any such interpretation is coming out, I'm sure the courts in their rational working will tone down the language and will read down and rationalize the application of law. So I'm skipping some of the sections. So the powers under the PMLA, as I said, to the enforcement directorate is in making inquiry and investigation. It can issue summons under section 50 and record the statements of the person who are accused of money laundering or who have abetted the offense of money laundering. Then it has power of carrying out survey and search and seizure under section 17 and 18 of the PMLA. Then it has also got power of arrest. Then the proceedings which are initiated by the enforcement directorate, first of all, proceedings for retention of records of properties. I mean, after the search and seizure, it can impound the records, and then it can also retain the properties. Then, nextly, it can make also the attachment of the property if the ED is authorized officer under the ED is of the opinion that the so-and-so attached, so-and-so asset which is of involved in the offense of money laundering is likely to be alienated. Then it can make attachment of such kind of assets. And not only attachment, then it can file an original complaint under section 5.5 of PMLA before the adjudicating authority. Then it can also simultaneously, as I mentioned a few minutes before you, file a complaint for launching prosecution against the offender under section 45 of PMLA before the special court. Then with regard to original application, in fact, whenever search is conducted, as I said, some documentary records are created there, and from the records, it may be quite possible that the enforcement directorate can seize some jewelry is found, jewelry may be seized, some title deeds may be found, they may be seized on the ground of their being involved in the offense of money laundering. So, but after the seizure is made, it is mandated for the adjudicating authority that within 30 days, it should file an original application, OA, which is popularly called, before the adjudicating authority, giving report of the entire matter that why they have made the seizure. And if the retention is required more than 30 days, then they will have to pursue with the OA. Otherwise, they will have to release the attachment within 30 days. And if the retention is required more than that period, original application is filed, as I mentioned, before the adjudicating authority. And then ED will have to justify his cause, why it should be extended, period should be allowed. And then the affected party, on the other hand, can also appear and make out a case that no such extended withholding or seizure of the asset is required. So therefore, it should be released, or maybe documents, or maybe title deeds, etc., etc. Then, if the assessing officer is of opinion that this property is likely to be alienated, it can make the attachment under section 5.1. of PMLA. And after it has made attachment under PMLA, it can file an original complaint before the adjudicating authority. So in a way, when the attachment is done by the Enforcement Directorate of the pursuits of crime, then it is duty bound to file an original complaint before the adjudicating authority. And then it hears like in a court-like manner, and there these arguments are made by the affected parties that the averments made in this original complaint are correct or not. And if the averment meets are not correct, then of course adjudicating authority can release the property. And if the allegations made in the, or the reasons given in the original complaint are not correct or legally sustainable in the eyes of law, then of course adjudicating authority can order for release of such kind of assets. And there can be many multiple grounds for attacking the averments made in the original complaint. Then friends, although the officer, authorized officer may proceed directly with the attachment of the pursuits of crime before a report under section 173 has been forwarded to the magistrate, if he has strong reason to believe on the basis of cogent material in his possession that if such property is not attached, immediately the proceedings under the act would be frustrated. This I will skip for the time being. As I said about the criminal prosecution, that the offense of money laundering as per section 3 of the PML is punishable with rigorous imprisonment for a term not less than 3 years, but which may extend to 7 years, and shall be liable to be fined. And where the scheduled offense has been committed under paragraph 2 of part A, then the maximum imprisonment is 10 years. So most heinous crimes, maximum is 10 years. Other crimes, I mean, it is maximum is 7 years. The prosecution under PMLA, unlike any other criminal prosecution, is initiated qua filing of prosecution complaint as prescribed under section 45 of the Act. The trial under the PMLA is a sessions trial and is governed by the provisions of CPC. Then, as I mentioned before you, that because of the vagueness in law or perceived vagueness in law, I mean, a lot of harshness is taking place because of the law which is mentioned in the books and the law, which is to be, I mean, seen to be have been followed in practice. Firstly, as I mentioned before you, that I am taking up the pursuits of crime wala controversy. So, as I said, that the definition of the section is clear, that in this definition, there are two parts. The first part is where the property is held in India, and the second part is where the property is held outside India. So if you talk about confined to first part, it only talks about the property may be attached or the value of any such property. Meaning thereby, if the property is infused with some other property, so the value of to that extent only. So only when the fusion of the same has been made with some other property, not before that. So for example, I will try to clarify the thing with the help of an example. Suppose I will take that example of smuggling only. Suppose a person did smuggling and he earned a sum of rupees 10 lakh after that, which is a scheduled offense, of course. And that 10 lakh rupees, he say deposited in the bank account and whatever he earned from smuggling, and that from this bank account, he purchased shares. He sold the shares of rupees, say worth rupees 50 lakhs. And from those 50 lakh rupees, whatever he earned thereafter, he bought a plot of rupees 70 lakhs. So rupees 20 lakh he added from his other clean resources, 50 lakh he added from there, and rupees 70 lakh plot of land he purchased. So what can be attached here? This 10 lakh rupees, which he earned, of course, it can be attached. Then this 10 lakh become eventually 50 lakh rupees. This bank account can be attached. Yes. Shares can be attached, which has become 50 lakh rupees. Yes. Because this 50 lakh rupees has got that 10 lakh rupees original from pursuits of crime, which has increased and became 50 lakh rupees. And similarly, if the plot of land is sold once again, so whatever profits is earned there, that proportionally can be attached. But what about rupees, this 20 lakh clean money which he has invested? No, to that extent, it cannot be attached. Similarly, I take another example. In the same fact, suppose this 50 lakh rupees he loses in casino. He invests in shares and then from there he earns rupees 50 lakhs and then he loses in casino. So under that circumstances, whether attachment can be done by the enforcement directorate of any other property, whether proceeds of crime would include any other property which is not derived from the proceeds of crime. So there is lot of confusion which has been made. Now kindly see, two clear situations have been carved out in this definition which I have put before you. First situation says where the money, where the property is held in India, then value of any such property, and where the property is taken outside India by the offender, then the any equivalent in value property also. So this distinction in user of the expression is clearly giving the intention of the legislature that any other property can be attached only in second situation. In first situation, only the value of that asset, the value may have increased in whatever manner, but that asset alone can be attached. Or if it is converted, then also converted, but to the extent where the original lies back to the that original proceeds of crime only. So meaning thereby, unless and until the assets under attachment has traced with the proceeds of crime, it cannot be treated as proceeds of crime and no attachment can be done. So this is a very, very important issue. Now, there is one more reasoning behind it. So these two situations, kindly see, I have divided these two situations in the slide. First situation is where the property is held in India and second situation is where property held outside India. So kindly see, the legislation has uses the word equivalent in second situation only. It has not been used in first situation. So whenever legislature uses a particular expression, there is a strong intention behind it. The legislature, user of the word is not a superfluous exercise. So since it is not a superfluous exercise, we cannot ignore also. So if we do not ignore, the word equivalent can be read in second situation only, not in first situation. Now there is one more reasoning to it. In fact, it has been provided under the law that ultimately the special court will confiscate the property which is involved in money laundering, else it will order for its release. So a property which is not involved in money laundering, which is another property, how can it be attached? Because it is not a matter of tax recovery, where even from the legal years the tax will be recovered. No, it is talking about something which is not permitted under the law, any kind of asset which is recognized as a bad asset under the law. So friends, any such thing, I mean, how it can be attached? So totally there, the law is very clear. So if the special court cannot make attachment of the property which is not involved in money laundering, so special court will have to release it. So if special court has to release it ultimately, then what is the objective of making its attachment today? But this kind of distinction has been blurred by the enforcement directorate. And that is where the most harsh situation is coming up today. Now, in fact, the same reasoning which I am giving before you, this very reasoning has been accepted recently by a latest judgment in the case of Seema Garg, delivered from Honorable Punjab and Haryana High Court. I have been giving this reasoning for last 1 year or so. And fortunately, the same reasoning has been given and accepted by Honorable Judicial High Court. And fortunately, there is one other judgment, that is Satyam Computers from Andhra Pradesh High Court, which also accepts the same reasoning. Though there is some tinkering, and Axis Bank of Delhi High Court is suggested to have taken some other view. But I would say the views very strongly and clearly given are in these two judgments, that is Seema Garg and Satyam Computers. And also some guidance is given by Delhi High Court in the case of Abdullah Ali Bashraf. That is also worth reading on this topic. Then, sir, Section 3, which I have already covered before you, that this problem is this because of this word "and". And that is why I also the problem is taking place. Now, I will come to that topic which I touched before you, that this burden of proof kind of thing is creating really a lot of trouble. Now, if you can kindly recollect, our Constitution of India is based on this fundamental concept that a person is innocent unless proved guilty. And the burden to prove that person is guilty is upon the prosecution. So unless the prosecution discharges that burden, that person cannot be said to be guilty. He is deemed to be innocent only. But there is a tinkering with regard to this kind of fundamental concept. And under Section 24 talks about burden of proof. I will read before you and then I will give my thoughts to it. In any proceeding relating to proceeds of crime under this Act, in case of person charged with the offense of money laundering, the authority or the court shall, unless the contrary is proved, presume that the such proceeds of crime are involved in money laundering. Now kindly see, as I said, that there are three kind of steps in any offense of money laundering. First of all, that there should be scheduled offense. Then second is there should be earning of proceeds of crime. And third is that proceeds of crime should be portrayed as good money. So kindly see, the burden has been shifted only with respect to third as facet. That once first two facets are proved, then the proof of third facet is upon the person who is charged. He has to revert this burden that he was not involved in offense of money laundering. But with regard to first two steps, there is no such presumption drawn against the accused. So therefore, if any such presumption is being drawn, that is being drawn illegally. And that is really causing a lot of harshness to the people in the country. So kindly see, as I said, there are three steps. First step is, say, person does commission of scheduled offense, then he earns proceeds, and then he converts into good money. So first two steps, that is commission offense, and that is earning proceeds thereof. This has to be the burden of the person who is alleging that these two facts exist, because the burden is upon the person who is alleging. Yes, because of the specific peculiar position of law, the third step may be presumed, that if two steps are proved, then with regard to the third step, that is the proceeds have been mingled with the good money, bad money has been mingled with the good money, maybe that presumption can be drawn against the person and that burden can be shifted. But provided earlier two burdens are proved by the department. So that is where there is a difference in law and difference as per practice, and which is creating a lot of tussle between the professionals, the people, and as well as the enforcement directorate. Then I also made a mention about section 5 of PMLA, which talks about attachment, that if the ED wants to make attachment of a property, then it has to first of all record reason to believe, and that so and so person is the possession of proceeds, and these are proceeds of crime, and such proceeds of crime are likely to be concealed, transferred, or dealt with in any manner which may result in frustrating any proceeding relating to confiscation of such POC. Another prerequisite is that such an attachment order can be passed only subsequent to the forwarding of a report under section 173 CRPC to the magistrate. So that report will relate to the alleged offense or crime, etc. Then this I will leave for the time being. Then, as I mentioned before you, that there is a power with the ED, that is, which is called power of search and seizure. So ED has been empowered to do survey, to do search, to do seizure, etc., etc. Under section 17, it has been given widest possible powers. Then under section 18 also, similar powers have been granted. Then this I am interplay part, I am skipping for want of time. And now after the attachment is done by the ED, then the matter goes into the hands of the, just one second, yes. Then once the this provisional attachment is done by the ED, then the immediate remedial measure available is its attachment. Because after the attachment is done, then it has to file PO, original complaint, and original complaint is to be disposed by the adjudicating authority within 180 days. So there are certain very, very fundamental requirements which the ED is required to follow. For example, it has to record reason to believe that why it is making attachment. So it is seen that the reason of belief is not served by the enforcement directorate, and therefore the issue arises before the adjudicating authority. And before the adjudicating authority also, the show cause notice, when it is given, the adjudicating authority does not record the reason while giving show cause notice. So these are the areas which we must take care of, and so that we can appropriately create a defense mechanism if such kind of lapses are done by the adjudicating authority or by the enforcement directorate. Then the adjudicating authority would hear all the parties involved, interested parties, affected parties, the main party whose asset has been attached, and then it decides ultimately whether the asset attached is a property involved in the offense of money laundering and it is right from the pursuit of crime or not. If it is, it thinks that it is not, then it can release the attachment. And if it thinks yes, it can be, then it will continue, it will confirm the provisional attachment order. So, I mean, during that period of 180 days, there is a heavy burden upon the professional, upon the chartered accountant and the lawyer, that how the representation is to be made effectively. Because if that time is wasted, then it becomes very difficult to support it with facts at later stage. So the way I would like to put forth our responsibility before the adjudicating authority is that we should have a proper blend of legal knowledge as well as knowledge of accounting and finance background, so that we can explain to the adjudicating authority that look, these are the alleged offences, and these are the alleged pursuits of crime. These have been invested in this and this manner. So even if some attachment is to be done, it is to be done of that trail only. Because the approach which the ED is following nowadays, so the moment there is a lack of clarity, they will make attachment of the whole lot available before them, which is causing very, very grave injuries to many people. So therefore, during the period of this period of 66 months, which we get during the course of original complaint before the adjudicating authority, we have to bring out the complete facts so that it could be convinced to the adjudicating authority that the impugned property is not involved in the money laundering, nor these are derived from the pursuits of crime, etc., etc. And friends, very important thing I am taking up before you, which is with regard to the interplay of various laws dealing with economic offences. Today, the scenario which has emerged, as I discussed with you in the beginning of the session, is that one law is affecting the other. So whatever actions are to be taken, whatever defense mechanism is to be created, that has to be taken or considered only after taking into account all the possible legislations which can trouble a person or governs the entire conduct. So for example, I will take 2-3 examples here. Suppose a person does money laundering. It is quite possible that he is not keeping the assets, all the assets, in his own name. So he may be keeping the asset in some other name. So the moment the result of the investigation is known to the investigation agencies, he can recommend the separate action under the Benami law also, because the assets are being in some other names, and vice versa also would be possible, may be possible. So, and maybe you, I don't know whether you are aware about that fact or not, that under Benami law also, it has been made duty of various government officers of the various government departments that if they come to know about any Benami transaction, that it is their duty to inform to the concerned or jurisdictional BPU. And vice versa is there. So if the officer calls for any information from any other agency, that he is also made duty bound to answer the same. So similarly, here also, the similar thing may arise. Now, let us take example of Companies Act. There are certain situations where the allegation of fraud having been done is put forth upon the directors. Say, for example, now new concept has come of explaining significant beneficial ownership concept. Now, under this concept, heavy duty has been cast upon a company that and the shareholders that in case the significant beneficial owner is someone else, then the company is required to give its reporting properly. So meaning thereby, if the person is registered shareholder but its significant beneficial owner is somebody else, so under Ben 1 and Ben 2, it is required to report. So if any such reporting is done, the other agencies may come into motion and can take some action about this, for the reason that suppose the shares have been acquired by that person by, say, some illegitimate activities. So then simultaneously, on the one hand, he will be making compliance under the Companies Act, but because of the action on the other part, I mean, some other action may take place, the ED can come into motion also. Similarly, if you kindly see, SEBI regulations are being tightened. The under the income tax law also. Now, this is very big question which is arising today. That, sir, whether tax evasion can also be put into the category of money laundering. So, whether tax evasion can give rise to money laundering, whether ED can take action. I think the answer is quite clear that the tax evasion as such is not involved, is not been named as scheduled offense, so does not itself amount to money laundering as tax evasion alone. But let us be very cautious on that in understanding the whole concept. While doing the tax evasion, if a person has done simultaneously some other offenses, say forgery, say cheating, say misrepresentation, so if any one of these activities has been named as punishable under IPC, which is in turn named as scheduled offense, because the definition of scheduled offense is very wide, then through that route, the tax evasion activity can also be roped in as part of money laundering. So therefore, there is a strong interplay between the income tax law as well as PMLA also. And also because of the reason, when the searches takes place, the whole material is gathered by the investigation wing. At that time, reference is also made to the enforcement directorate on various matters, and vice versa. Whenever searches are done by the enforcement directorate, and if some reports about the tax evasions are received, then those are also sent to the income tax department. I will try to also explain with the help of an example. Suppose a person does some kind of, say he did some smuggling. And from the smuggling, he earned a sum of rupees, say 10 crores. So out of these 10 crores, suppose he reported in his return of income that income from smuggling at rupees 10 crores. And he files his return. So let us evaluate what kind of laws are violated here. First of all, Customs Act, yes. FEMA, yes. Income Tax Act, no, because he has reported full rupees 10 crores. Milo, no. Black Money Act, no, apparently no. PMLA, now because of he has shown it as income from smuggling only, he is not converting into as good money. So I don't think that he can be roped into PMLA also. Let us leave aside that amendment made with effect from 1/8/2019, though it does not change the position according to me. But for the timing, it will not. Now let me little bit change the facts in the same situation. Now, suppose that person, out of rupees 10 crores, he shows in his income tax return as rupees 2 crores only as income from consultancy. Out of the balance amount of rupees 8 crores, 3 crores he sends abroad to be stashed in his undisclosed bank account. Out of rupees 5 crores, he gives it to B Limited. His name is, say, Mr. R. Mr. R gives to B Limited to be given back to R Limited in the form of share capital. So R gives cash to B Limited. B Limited gives back checks to R Limited in the form of share capital, and R Limited issues share certificates to B Limited. So now let us evaluate again, what are the offenses which have taken place under what laws? For example, first of all, customs, yes. FEMA, of course, yes. Then Income Tax Act, yes, because out of 10 crores, he has shown only rupees 2 crores. So there is a suppression of 8 crore rupees. Then Binami Law, yes. Because he is keeping the share capital in the name of Mr. B Limited, who is not the real shareholder. Then there can be strong allegation of Binami Law. Then violation of Binami Law. Then Black Money Act, yes, he has sent rupees 3 crores to be stashed in his undisclosed bank account. So violation under Black Money Act has also indeed taken place. And then what about PMLA? Yes, it is a straight case where he is converted entire rupees 10 crores as good money, which was actually tainted property, bad money, and money from scheduled offenses. So that is how, under these circumstances, he will be roped under any law and every law, whichever I have discussed with you. So that is how I can say that there is a strong interplay between various laws here. Now, friends, I will take one or two case studies Now, first case study, I will take up about this distillery unit. How the things happened bad to worst here in this case. So one distillery unit was set up in 2005 and around 500 workers were working therein. And it started manufacturing the spirit. And there were some allegations, unfortunately, that it has done some violation of Pollution Control Act, Water Pollution Control Act. So complaint was filed by the Pollution Control Board. And FIR was also filed, and then complaint was also filed. But no action was taken thereafter because it had set up water pollution treatment plant. And that is how probably no further action was taken. It was still pending. But in the meanwhile, ED swings into action and issues the notice for attachment of the factory. So we represented it. We initially could not understand that how this water pollution and how this ED is coming for attachment. I mean, so then the reasoning which was given by the ED was that this Water Pollution Control Act violation was done, which is a scheduled offense. And then I thought ki how then it can be converted in monetary terms. Then the allegation was that its license capacity was say 50 KL per year, and it has discharged 75 KL per year. So it means 25,000 KL it has discharged extra water into the river. So that means the distillery unit has made extra production to that extent, which is beyond license capacity. And by doing this, it has done violation. And because of the violation, it is from proceeds of crime. Extra production means extra sales. Extra sales means extra profit. So an extra profit becomes proceeds of crime, which have been invested in the factory building. So that is why notice for attachment of the factory was given. Somehow we could get from the court the notice of status quo, but this is such a harsh law. See, on the one hand, 10 years back some violation was done under Water Pollution Control Act, and now and again in 2012 or 13 they make suddenly the attachment under PMLA, which is unthinkable by any standards. Then case study number two, one gentleman did some dealing in Bitcoin, unaware of where he can land himself into trouble. So eventually what happened? That FIR was filed against that company with whom he was dealing because of certain lapses made by it. So all over the country, FIRs were filed against that company. And this gentleman was perceived to be very close to the management and also a party to the offense. So action was taken upon him also, not only by the investigation agency, then later on by the ED also. So his FDRs were attached for the reason that you have done the illegal activity of dealing in the Bitcoins. And also you have done the illegal activity of supporting that company in its cheating to the public, etc., etc. Whereas he was only one of the investors, but because of this vagueness, somewhere arose and the action was taken upon him. So that, I mean, that much harsh this law sometimes become. And actually, friends, as I have been quite often saying that when the time has come, when we must realign ourselves, and we should not have the knowledge of only that subject in which we are dealing, but also of other allied subjects which may affect. Because if we do not do so we may save our client from clutches of one law in most legal possible manner, but we may not be knowing the effect having on other laws, and he may come out of the well and he may be pushed into a deep valley of the other law. So that is how I also say that this PMLA law is a law where the where neither the chartered accountant in itself is sufficient enough to tackle the problems arising here, to represent it alone, nor the lawyer alone is sufficient. So lot of, you know, a good amount of fusion is required of knowledge of accountancy and law background both. So one of the most important role which I consider of chartered accountant brothers and sisters here is in helping the people in computing, the authorities in computing the exact amount of proceeds of crime and the assets where they are located. Now how this law is becoming very harsh. One another reason which I forgot to mention is this also, that here not only the main offender is roped in, but any offender, but any person who has done with any dealing any with the person who is accused of offense of money laundering can also put himself into trouble. Now, I will give you an example on the basis of which you can probably understand what I am trying to say. Suppose a big businessman, business house took loan, business group took loan, say of 1,000 crore rupees from consortium of bankers. Unfortunately, the group collapsed financially because of poor business, it did. And the loan became NPA, it became defaulter. So, sensing some troubles, the banker filed complaint before the CBI on the ground that the loan was obtained by way of some forgery, cheating, giving forged documents, misrepresentation, etc., etc., which is one of the scheduled offense because it is punishable under IPC and may be named as scheduled offense. So therefore, complaint is filed to the ED also by the CBI. Because it is a scheduled offense which is committed from their pursuits of crime are earned and pursuits of crime is that loan of rupees 1,000 crore. So ED makes investigation. So far as the attachment of the properties of that group is concerned, no problem because for 1,000 crore, whatever properties it has acquired should be attached. But whosoever may have dealt with that group may also put himself into trouble unknowingly sometimes if the dealing is not proved to be at arm's length price, which may quite often happen under business, very complex situations arise. So the heavy burden comes upon the person whosoever has done dealing. Most of the cases pending with the EDs of this nature only where bank defaults have been done. So under these circumstances, it becomes a bounden duty to properly compute that how the proceeds have traveled. And I have made one checklist kind of thing to help you in this direction. That first of all, identifying the source of the attached properties and differentiating it with the alleged POC, identifying loan utilization in the attached properties, calculation of the correct value of any alleged POC, valuation of the property attached and comparison with the alleged POC, proper financial accounting analysis, preparation of money trail for the attached properties to demarcate the source of funds. All these things look to be easy, but it becomes very, very difficult when we are talking about the volumes of 1,000 crores and more, because wherever they have traveled, all those persons are, you know, covered in the net of the ED. And then one needs to explain what is actually POC, what is actually not. And thick knowledge, sophisticated knowledge of accounting background is required there. So many such cases are happening today. For example, this Brazilian government action, which has happened because of the agreement which has entered by the Indian government with Brazilian government that they will mutually cooperate and take action on with respect to the sharing of information and also curbing the money laundering by way of withholding the property, attaching the property of the person who is involved in the money laundering. So the unfortunate part is the principles of natural justice are violated. The law is neither properly understood nor properly implemented. And that is where the role of the judiciary comes. But by the time judiciary intervenes into the subject, the lot of damage is done. And the most harsh provision is not only burden of proof, which I mentioned. One other provision which I talk about is that the power has been given to the ED that the moment adjudicating authority confirms the attachment, ED can take possession of that asset. So see the situation that there is no judicial application of mind so far, because adjudicating authority itself writes in its order that our limited role is to see broadly whether offense has been done, property is covered. So proper judicial application of mind, neither there is a sufficient infrastructure, nor they are trained, nor they do, nor they have any temperament, nor they have attitude. So without proper judicial application of mind, if possession is taken over by a executive department of any asset of a person, that person may be financially doomed. Such kind of, even if it is after 10 years or so, that property is released back by the court, but the property may perish at that time. By that time, financially, the person may be doomed. So I think drastic amendment is required in that rule, which is giving such kind of power, and or proper training should be given to make proper and fair implementation of this law. So friends, still there are many things. This is such a wide subject. But I wanted to give a small introduction to this subject to my professional brothers and sisters. I am really thankful to all of you for sparing such a valuable time and for such a keen participation. Thank you very much. I think whatever questions are possible, we can definitely take up whichever can be delivered on this forum. Thank you, Vivek ji. Thank you, Neha ji. And thank you, respected Dash sir, for sparing the valuable time. Thank you very much, sir. Yes, sir.
Let's take the query, sir. I would say all our compliments to Ashwini, sir, for explaining the toughest law in the most simplest and easiest manner. Looking at the queries, I think 90% of the queries have already been solved in your presentation itself.
Still, we can take a few queries.
Absolutely, sir. So there is a query by Prakash Chandra Bansali. Sir, whether entries taken by the assessee of loan by giving cash to lender can be covered under this act?
देखिए प्रकाश भाई, एक तो ये वर्ड एंट्रीज और ये सब ना अब इतनी खतरनाक हो गई हैं कि हमें इनसे दूर बचना होगा, क्योंकि अपना जितने भी लॉज हैं, आप चाहे पीएमएल ले लीजिए, चाहे बेनामी ले लीजिए, और डैश साहब इसमें अच्छे से एक्सप्लेन करेंगे कि सब में लिखा है कि अबेटर को सबसे पहले पकड़ना है, चाहे आप बेनामी, साफ साफ लिखा है. नंबर एक. नंबर टू, नाम ही एंट्री हुआ है तो उसमें कितनी सारी इंप्लीकेशन होंगी, किस लॉ में होंगी, बेनामी में भी होंगी, क्योंकि एंट्री लेते टाइम आपने कुछ फोर्जरी की है, तो पीएमएलए में भी हो सकती है. तो वी आर ऑन द मर्सी ऑफ दीज डिपार्टमेंट्स, आई मीन वी मीन्स दोस पर्सन हु हैव डन दिस काइंड ऑफ आई मीन थिंग्स, दे आर ऑन द मर्सी ऑफ दीज एनफोर्समेंट एजेंसीज, दे कैन कवर इन एनी मैनर. सो आई मीन दैट्स व्हाट सेट द बेटर विद रिस्पेक्ट टू दिस.
Sir, this is a query by Sanjeev Agarwal. Please clarify that whether an order of penalty passed under Section 271AAD of the Income Tax Act, can it be treated as scheduled offence under PMLA?
No, Gaurav ji, as I mentioned, income tax violation or tax evasion simpliciter is not a scheduled offence, thankfully and gratefully to the Honorable Government. And that is why there is no overlapping between the Income Tax Department and the ED. So, unless and until some other offense has also been done in the process, as I mentioned. So, if this kind of penalty which you are talking about is imposed and it is proved that some forgery has been done, which is punishable offense under PMLA, also under that particular section of IPC. So, it is such a dangerous action on the part of Income Tax Department. I mean, dangerous, I am saying it is prone for, I mean, an action from the PMLA department also.
So there's another query by Prakash Chandra Bansali, sir. Whether immovable property purchased from a government employee by taking a loan from bank can be attached by ED if it later on found that the government employee had bought it by using corrupt money?
I think the question itself contains the answer. But I think SAP can more appropriately deal with it because we should have the benefit of his presence also. And if the need will arise, then I will also give my views later on. Sir.
Thank you very much. The government servant who used corrupt money, laundered his corrupt money in creating an asset, it becomes proceeds of a crime. And that proceeds of a crime was sold to another person. So, technically it can be attached, but the person who took bank loan, who used his good money, he has to become a claimant before the adjudicating authority and explain his sources so that he could prove that in his hands, it is the house does not become proceeds of a crime. The money that he has given to the government officer has washed away the sins of that house. The house is clean and the monies that may be available with the government officer becomes proceeds of a crime.
So the burden will be very, very heavy upon the person now who is claiming immunity to show that the transaction was bona fide. It was at arm's length. So that is why I have written one article also on this subject that, I mean, you may also suffer even if you are not the main offender. But merely because you have dealt with an offender, I mean, that itself may be your crime. Though you may say, sir, how surprising it is and how difficult may it then be living in the country. So that is why I am saying we must align and realign ourselves. While dealing with anyone, we should ensure that we are dealing at arm's length price. If it is not done so, then the moment that person has done anything bad, you will also be party to that. Simple and straight.
Sir Sanjeev Chawla has a request. If you could give one more example of an interplay of Benami and PML LOs.
Now, while doing any money laundering activity, if a person takes the asset in some other name also, say, whatever proceeds he has earned and he keeps in some other name. So, straight away, there will be money laundering as well as Benami. And that is what is most likely to happen in any case, because to hide his crime, to portray it as good money, he will create some structures, he will get the property in some other names. So the moment it is proved that this is the proceeds earned from there and proceeds are invested there and it is the properties are taken in the names of some family members or friends or relatives, Benami law will simultaneously will come. And the moment other way around also, suppose the Benami property is detected by a Benami officer, BPU, and then BPU gives a finding that the proceeds were actually proceeds of crime, and to hide that he has taken in this name, so the matter will go to the ED also. So that is how there is going to be, strong interplay between the two.
Sir, there is a query by Mukund Rawat. Which would prevail, IBC or PMLA?
2-3 things I would mention here, and then Dash sir can answer. Please supplement to me. In fact, this is the biggest question which is now arising in every law, and there is a question which has become quite prevalent nowadays. That every law states 2 things. Number one, this law is in addition to any other law, provisions of any other law, and not in subjugation of any other law. Number two, that in case there is any inconsistency between this law and any other law, then this law shall have a supersession effect. Coming back to PMLA, PMLA has this kind of provision. IBC has the same provision. So then the answer lies in very, very specific. Which part is very specific in a given situation should prevail? So this controversy had been a controversy or prevalent in the entire country. And to take care of this controversy, when this arose in Jindal Steel's case, the government came out with an amendment, and one section 32A of IBC has been introduced, where it has been clearly said that once the resolution is passed, this, that, and all that, then the ED's attachment should be over. The resolution profession should be allowed to dispose of the assets and go ahead with the plan. Yeah, ED can definitely hold the persons responsible for prosecution who have done the offense of money laundering, that is previous directors, management, or anybody who has offense. So as far as property is concerned, property becomes the clean property. Clean means free for selling and disposal, etc. But offense remains, and for the liability of the person, for punishment remains. So that is how the interplay is done. And I hope Dasha would also have something to say on this.
I would say, like the courts in this matter have said, Delhi High Court, that both the laws have to
coexist.
Harmony. You see, the courts have found that it is possible to harmonize the existence of both the laws. And the example has been given by Mr. Taneja, that when the PML action precedes IBC, then PML prevails. If IBC precedes PML action, that prevails. But the rigors of a punishment part will always, stigma and punishment will always remain. Only the property can become free or not free, depending on the timings.
Thank you, sir. So the next query we have is from Chirag Shah. While guiding our clients, what precautions should we take to avoid unnecessarily getting into PMLA?
ये बहुत ही अच्छा सवाल पूछा है चिराग आपने. I must congratulate you for this question. देखो मैं इसको इस तरह से कहता था कि एडवाइजर को एडवाइजर होना चाहिए, पार्टी टू बी नहीं होना चाहिए कभी भी. अगर हमने बिजनेस ही करना होता एडवाइजर ने तो बिजनेस ही करता ना, और जब बिजनेस नहीं किया तो एडवाइजर ही रहो. अब एक सेक्शन आती है 126 ऑफ इंडियन एविडेंस एक्ट, जिसको कहते हैं कि साहब एक एडवोकेट साहब ने प्रूलेस कम्युनिकेशन में उनको आप रिस्पॉन्सिबल होल्ड नहीं कर सकते. यस नहीं कर सकते, प्रोवाइडेड ही इज ओनली एडवाइजिंग. इफ ही स्टार्ट्स एडवाइजिंग हिज क्लाइंट आप ऐसे करो, अच्छा वहां कोई विटनेस था, हाँ जी था मर्डर साइट पर, तो आप ऐसे करो उसको फिनिश करके आओ, फिर मैं आपको चिताता हूँ इस केस में। तो वो फिर एडवोकेट नहीं रहा, आर्टिकल ऑफ क्राइम हो गया। सिमिलरली कोई चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट के पास आता है कि सर मैंने हाउस प्रॉपर्टी सेल किया है और इसमें मेरे को कैपिटल गेन कंप्लीट कर दीजिए, तो हमने पूछा कितने का आपने बेचा है साहब, बोले साहब 1 करोड़ रुपए का बेचा है। अच्छा तो कॉस्ट ऑफ एक्विजिशन कितनी थी, 10 लाख रुपीज थी। तो साहब कैपिटल कितना लगेगा, साहब ये इंडेक्स कॉस्ट करके 70 लाख लगेगा, तो इसको सर बचाना है। तो अच्छा ऐसे करो तो कॉस्ट ऑफ इंप्रूवमेंट बताओ कितना है, तो बोले साहब नहीं ऐसे करो तुम कुछ बिल लेके आओ, उसमें बिल डालो कॉस्ट ऑफ इंप्रूवमेंट के। ये जो आपका पार्टी टू द क्राइम शुरू हो गया, अब खाली आप एडवाइजर नहीं रहे, आप कुछ और बन गए। तो ये आपको ये ध्यान रखना है, कोई भी एवरीबडी हैज राइट ऑफ डिफेंस और देयर इज नो हार्म इन इट, कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन सेज प्रोवाइडेड यू आर प्रोवाइडिंग इन डिफेंस ओनली, नॉट परपेट्रेटिंग द क्राइम इटसेल्फ। सो एडवाइजर का रोल एडवाइजरी होना चाहिए। यू हैव लर्न, you have to learn, we all of us have to learn to deal in at arm's length principle. I think that's the only concept which we can keep in mind, and I will request Dasap to elaborate it more, because this is very very important area and we are all very apprehensive because agencies have become quite aggressive. They also sometimes do not distinguish between right and wrong, sometimes become quite active in taking actions. By the time the real facts are known, I mean image or reputation of a person is already destroyed. So I think Dasap, you would like to speak something on this. This is a very important issue and immense guidance is required on this issue.
So in fact, very frankly, as a professional, if somebody is consulting you, you can tell him to take as many precautions as possible, as much due diligence as possible in every kind of a transactions, even entering into a contract. Taking a loan, previously many chartered accountants would brush up the balance sheet so that the person, the entity can take a higher amount of loan like this. So any amount of a precaution that one can take is not also adequate given the rigors of the law. So very you right. have to be really very very careful in all your actions, whether you very take a loan, give a loan, give a gift, take a gift, it should be real. That should, when you have a company part, so who are the if it is a Benami company or it is a real company, that all those things have to be really taken care of. So as a professional, as Aswini ji clearly said, you have to handle it as a real professional at arm's length and ensure that the true facts that you know, and take care to gather all that facts that is possible. Merely because whatever he is saying, it is not enough. You have to, if he says that he brought it from bank, you know, as a CA, you have to audit that aspect also. So it is necessary to take all possible and rigorous due diligence in all aspects of work that you undertake for your client.
Thank you, sir. One of the last queries of the session by Mr. Chaturvedi. If the loan is taken in 2001 or 2004, does it come under PMLA? Because the law was passed in 2005 and scheduled offenses were incorporated in 2009 itself.
In fact, this is also another controversy which is going on. Suppose an offense, when the offense was done, scheduled offense, at that time it was not a scheduled offense, then how it can be, whether it can be roped in. Now there ED is taking one peculiar plea, ki, sir, okay sir, scheduled offense was done at that time, but the proceeds derived therefrom continue to be held today. So if it is held to be today, and when it has become scheduled offense, it was continued that also. So it is a kind of continuing offense. So that is why it should be covered today also. So this is a very gray area. I think it should not be covered, but still this is not free from controversy. So due care should be taken in this direction also.
So thank you very much, sir, for such a wonderful presentation. Really, it was a great, and with Dr. Saab, it's much and much great. Yes, sir, you want to talk? You want to say something, Dr. Saab?
Yes, sir. You're saying something?
No, yes. He's muted probably. Vivekji is muted. He was saying something, but it was not heard.
No, I can. We can hear Vivekji. I think we can all hear Vivekji.
Okay. Yes. I could not probably.
So, sincere thanks to both of you. Ashwini Taneja ji, sir, really thank you. And many thanks are coming. Lovely session. Thank you. Wonderful session. Valuable information. And also, Dr. Saab, such a wonderful session. And we need more and more your services. And we'll ask Neha to take more dates from yourself, so that at least in a month, one session from your side to guide our members. Because nowadays, every day some changes are into different laws. So once again, my sincere thanks to you. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
And tomorrow we have another webinar. We'll meet at 4:30. It's the Excel as audit tool. So thank you very much. Bye-bye.